Setting it up, here goes De Beer again. Is that going to pop over the crossbar? Yes! My word, it has done it again! That's drop number four.
It had never been done before in any international.
His turn! His turn! Five drop kicks! That has got to be some awesome record!
How ironic it is that England's World Cup exit in the quarterfinals should come courtesy of not one, but five drop goals.
But the Yanni De Beer show has absolutely made this game South Africa's.
A hiding delivered by a relentless Springbok side.
Can he get it down? Yes!
Still, truth or dare for the Wallabies.
Joe Robert Greenhead! Yes!
Still, yet to fulfill their promise.
Larkham! Tune!
But good enough to defeat their tenacious hosts.
Today, because there was so much expectation. It's such a sad way to go out.
Now, the acid test for the world champions of 1991 and 95. And when the full-time whistle finally blows tonight, one of these two teams will have the chance again to have the world at their feet.
And the last time the Australian team bus made this trip to Twickenham for a World Cup match was way back in 1991 when they won the William Webellis Trophy. The Australian team bus of 99 makes its way slowly in to the home of English football. Twickenham, of course, the venue for the first semi-final of Rugby World Cup 1999. Plenty of green and gold there, but I can tell you part of that green and gold will be the contingent of South African supporters as well. They are there in their thousands to cheer on the defending champions. Tonight is a moment of destiny for both sides as we welcome you right around Australia, David Fordham for Seven Sport, as we bring you live and exclusive coverage of the first semi-final. We'll be crossing very shortly to our commentary team at Twickenham, as these two combatants, they really know what it's all about. They've been there before. In 1991, the Australian Wallabies were the world champions, and in 1995, South Africa, their opponents tonight, were the world champions as well. Well, how did they make their way in 1999 to the showdown at Twickenham? The Wallabies won their pool, Pool E, with wins over Romania, Ireland and the United States, where they conceded their only try of the tournament. Last week at the Millennium Stadium in Cardiff, they overcame a determined Wales to advance to the final four. South Africa, the defending world champions, topped their pool, Pool A, with wins over Scotland, Spain and Uruguay, and riding high on a 34-point haul from fly half Yanni De Beer, advanced to the semi-finals last weekend with a sound win over England. So here's this weekend's semi-final format for Rugby World Cup 1999. Tonight, Australia up against South Africa, and tomorrow, also at Twickenham in London, France and New Zealand. And standing by at Twickenham, our commentary team headed up by Gordon Bray. Gordon, there is amazing expectation here in Australia, and the build-up reminds me very much of 1991 when Australia met New Zealand at Lansdowne Road. Two great teams as it is tonight, but unfortunately only one can advance to the final next weekend.
Well, Fordo, a replay of 1991 semi-final would be just dandy for the Wallabies, but it began in 1996. Norway and Latvia played the first qualifying game. 65 countries started. Now we're down to the big boys, and today it's the winners of the last two World Cups, Australia and South Africa. The bookies say it's too close to call. Nick Farr-Jones is a man who loves to chance his arm. What's your prediction?
Well, Gordon, all week everyone's been calling it too difficult to call. I'm prepared to put the head on the block, but it's a conditional putting the head on the block. I think if the condition is that the scrum holds up, they'll try and rock us there. If we can win 80-90% of our line-out throw, and importantly, we can dominate dominate the breakdown or at least match the Springboks, I really believe that we've got too much strength, too much skill, too much creativity out wide. I think that could be a two-try difference for the Australians.
There's Matt Cobain, who's had a few problems with his knee, but he trained well in the captain's run. A lot of Wallaby supporters went to the captain's run yesterday, and Todd Ikefu back, of course, after that suspension. He's been out for 3 weeks, and Tim Horan has been under an injury cloud with that stomach bug. Well, who can forget what happened in 1995 in the final? The deadlock between South Africa and New Zealand, dramatically broken in extra time by a drop goal. Here's more from Chris Handy.
Yeah, good, and what a moment that was. And I have with me the previous Boca Le Drop, Monsieur Joel Stransky. What's it feel like to give it up to Yanni to be a five-drop goal?
Chris, I've got to be really honest, you know, I've never thought of myself as Monsieur Le Drop, as you put it. I've always sort of seen myself as a player who, you got one or two over, one lucky one when it really counted. But he certainly is the maestro of kicking the ball out of hand. Great drop goal expert.
That determines a particular style of game, doesn't it? To be able to kick five drop goals. Do you think that's what we'll see out here today from the Springboks?
I don't think so, because I think Australia will be a lot more streetwise than England were. I think they made a couple of bad mistakes.
And that a beautiful moment, of course, poetry in motion, kicking that goal. How did you feel?
Oh, it felt fantastic. You know, it's a special moment. It'll obviously live with me forever. And it's not something else in study, but it does bring goosebumps every time I see it.
Well, there we saw lots of passionate Springboks supporters. And here today, there's still more of them. Could you believe how many green and gold? We don't mind green and gold, but a lot of them are Springboks.
Well, I'm told that there were 7 jumbos that left South Africa yesterday afternoon alone.
So did somebody turn out the lights?
There's a lot of people left to come over, and it's great to see them all out here, because I've got a feeling we're going to need them all making a lot of noise today.
Yeah, well, Joel Stransky, you know what it is about big-time rugby, and it is a special moment. Do you feel your Blacks will get home in the end?
Well, it is special. You know, and every major test is vital, and to wear your national jersey, whether you play for Australia or South Africa or New Zealand or whoever it is a fantastic moment. But to play here at Twickenham, the home of rugby, World Cup semi-final against Australia, one of the great teams. It's a big day for South Africa.
Yeah, well, there you go, Gordon. That's it from Joel Stransky. That's how he's reading it.
And welcome now to Simon Poitevin, who held up the Webberless Cup here in 1991. The Aussie forwards have been very underrated. What is their role today?
Well, the game will be won on the forwards today. There's no doubt about that. The scrum has to be supreme against South Africa. The line-out also, in particular, Cobain versus Spencer, is a critical part of the game. The forwards must go forward and take the pressure off Gregan and Larkin, then the Australian backs can express themselves. Without that full platform, we've got no chance.
Well, Simon, the Wallabies are in very good fettle. They've had a very relaxed build-up to this game in their rural retreat, but really they've been on a high since last weekend. Again, an overlap for Roth. Joe Roth with Gregan. Yes! The brand new cathedral of Welsh rugby has only firmed Wallaby resolve for an encore on November 6. 24-9 to the Wallabies. They're through to Twickenham. Back in England, the Aussies' rural base southwest of London has been the perfect retreat. A haven for Coach McQueen in a cup semi-final build-up.
I've been very pleased with the players' own assessment of themselves. We're not playing the best of our ability at the moment, and now what we've got to do is take another step up this week.
The hotel is normally home for England's soccer team, but if it came to a contest for food consumption, you'd back down under all the way. In the finest English traditions, the Wallabies have relished their therapeutic setting, and goal kicker Matt Burke has even found a new way to fine-tune his radar. Burke has also kept busy with his tour diary on the official Wallaby website, already boasting 3.5 million hits from eager fans.
You know, from the 91 World Cup team, it was faxes galore, now it's emails galore, so how times have changed, but there's still fantastic support for us.
And back on the subject of edible delights, Jeremy Paul and Tom Bowman stole the limelight, stepping into some famous skins. Jeremy happy to take a blow from Richard Harry, but definitely not happy about this one from Craig Quinnell. The sighting commissioner was obviously unsighted. This is a crucial match up front for the big boys. Oz Durant versus Andrew Blades, a classic case of Springbok brute strength versus Wallaby biomechanic efficiency.
You know, it's one of those things you think about and have nightmares about for about a week before the game, and you know all about it for a couple of days afterwards. So I'm going to have to be concentrating very hard this weekend.
Blades and his teammates won't be hiding this afternoon. It's now one shot at glory, and the Wallabies are ready to fire. And there's the Wallaby team lineup. A big day for Joe Rock, his 50th cap. Andrew Blades spoke to his wife Nikki on a teleconference yesterday. She's watching back home with the new bub. And the scene here at Twickenham is rising to the top. We're simmering at the moment. The Wallabies are warming up on the field. There they are on the right. And we're now awaiting a grand occasion, the semi-final. There's Steve Nance, formerly with the Brisbane Broncos, who's really got these guys tuned up. Joe Rock, the youngest man ever to play 50 Test matches. A great day for him here at Twickenham. More of the build-up after these words. Back shortly. Supporters are outnumbered here, Nick Barr-Jones, by the Springbok fans here today. Both sides are out on the field at the moment warming up, but yeah, there seems to be a predominance of South African support. Am I imagining things?
No, there's certainly plenty of them out there, and as the viewers can see, Gordon, plenty of wind here up in the commentary, but down on the field, very, very gusty, and there's going to be a lot of high balls, one assumes. I wouldn't think they'll be throwing too much to the back of the lineout. And about 10 minutes ago, Yanni De Beer, of course, who torpedoed England a little while ago, he was practicing his drop goals. Downwind, he'll be putting them over from 50 metres if he gets a chance.
And the traffic is just chaos outside, Simon. The Springboks caught in a jam too.
Yep, police escort couldn't get him through, and just a huge number of Springbok supporters. It's like Ellis Park here, unfortunately.
And Ewis van der Westhuizen, there are little green and gold mini miners going around saying, "Ewis, do it." And the South Africans very focused for this big game, as we would appreciate. But certainly we've seen how relaxed the Australians are for this semi-final at their rural retreat. I wonder just how the Springboks have been building up for this do-or-die war game. The Springboks are unbeaten in two World Cups, but according to their skipper, the spirit of 95 is not a factor this time around.
No, we don't even talk about 95. That's a thing of the past. No, this is it's a new game. It's going to be Clash of the Titans. I think the best team with the best discipline will come out on top.
After winning last year's Tri-Nations under new coach Nick Mallett, the South Africans came tumbling to earth in 99 before arresting a four-loss streak with a one-point win over the Wallabies.
There's no question that New Zealand and Australia were going to come through. I think they had a really good season and the Tri-Nations played really well. It was just a question of whether we could find our form before, for the England match. And I'm very pleased that we did. And it does say a lot for the Super 12 competition, the fact that the guys are capable of raising their game.
And surprise, surprise, the Springboks have an Aussie in their camp. Former soapy actor and Sydney journalist Alex Bruin is their media officer.
Whether you call them the Springboks or the Amaboka Boka or whatever you choose to call them, I can tell you that when the box won on Sunday in Johannesburg, people were blowing whistles and honking horns and going crazy. And we've had to tell everybody back in South Africa to just calm down a bit, you know. We haven't done anything yet. But there's such love for the players, and they are the pop stars, if you like, of South Africa.
De Beer, another drop kick. He's turned. Yanni De Beer watches it. The hand goes up. He's got it again.
After his world record 5 drop goals, Yanni De Beer proudly carries the banner of God, but is not claiming divine intervention.
Personally, as far as my relationship with God is, if we win the World Cup or not, because it's not going to make a difference. He's always going to love me. He's always going to be there for me. So in a sense, it's easier for me to just go out there and play and enjoy it. And on a day, we'll see what happens. If we win, we win. If we don't, we don't.
So let the final battle lines be drawn by the man they call the Ox.
There is a bit of blood, and if you get head wounds and stuff like that, I think there'll definitely be a bit of bleeding. But that's also a good thing.
Well, blood spilt, and certainly a lot of paint was spilt by the Springboks in their bonding session. But the crowd is certainly filling into the stadium now here at Twickenham. And there's the South African team lineup. It's unchanged from the team that performed so well here against England at Twickenham last week. Well, the car park at Twickenham is quite unique. It's a real tradition to be out there with your bubbly and also your picnic hampers. And we've been out to just sample proceedings. A lot of very expensive cars, entertainment supplied, but the very best in vintages, of course, and the bubbly really does flow. And I'm sure Chris Handy has been sniffing around down there, maybe trying to find a few Australian supporters. Over to you, Chris.
Lindsay Lamb, come
out. What's it like being an Australian, a Wallaby amongst all these Springboks?
That's fairly difficult at the moment, I'll tell you.
Who do you think will win?
Who do you think?
No, I just think it's wonderful to have you all. Would you like a vodka tomato?
Oh, of course, but not on camera. As a former Wallaby, what's it like?
Oh, it's fantastic to be here, Buddha. Great expectations today. It's great excitement. An event like this you just can't see in Australia. We've been over to the tents and the areas and the entertainment, the social life here is just unparalleled.
Well, here's a mad grip. You blokes probably don't give us stuff today.
No, no, we're going for the Oz because we don't want South Africa to win again.
Oh, what happened to the Pommies last week?
Aussie backs are too good,
should
I think.
Should be Wales, England.
I wasn't impressed with Africa last week. De Beer kicked on his kicks, but the Aussie backs are great.
And we have a look at this. British beef at its best off the bone. Hey, what a great way to celebrate in Twickers Carpet. On the bone.
Off the bone, whatever.
What about those Frenchmen? Do we like them or what?
No, we don't talk about them because we talk about British meat being best.
Feed the boys meat. Do you think those South Africans look like they're 15 mongrel dogs at a butchery window? Is that the sort of look on their face or what?
Oh, I don't know. I'd like to get close enough to find out.
I mean, do you think the car park lacks a little bit of that atmosphere that England's not playing?
But it's still fairly early. I think the car park's going to fill up and there'll be a lot of atmosphere later on.
I think the patrons might fill up as well.
Could well do. Another grass campaign, all right. It'd be wonderful.
Now, Chris Handy, the mad butcher in the Twickenham car park, and the French team have been eating plenty of British beef, I can tell you that, in their build-up. But Chris, or Tim Horan, hasn't been because he's had a very nasty stomach bug. Let's hear the latest now. Back to you, Chris.
Well, Rod McQueen, Tim Horan, key factor in the Wallaby team for today. How is he? He was ill overnight, but is he well?
Still a few concerns there about Tim. He believes he'll be right to play. We're going to have to keep a bit of an eye on him over the game and make sure he doesn't run out of puff because he's been bad for a couple of days now.
What's the fallback position?
Well, obviously, Nathan Gray's there and he'll be on the bench waiting. And he trained yesterday again, so he's had plenty of time. And we'll see how he goes. We've got confidence he'll be all right.
You've taken a bit of a gamble. You've got Rodmore as the reserve in the front race. It's going to be hard up front. Has he got the juice in the tank?
Well, obviously, we hope so. We've had a few injury problems there, obviously, and we really agonised over that decision. But obviously, Alec Evans and Farley had a bit to do with the final decision there. They've got confidence that he'll be able to hold the scrum up well, so I have too.
Thanks, Rod. Good luck.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Rod McQueen looking very relaxed. So too John Williamson. He's obviously building up for his rendition of the Australian anthem, so he's in very good company there. And I think the fans are building up because kickoff is close at hand. Bring Back Bill is the campaign here for the Wallabies. They have to do it here today to reach Millennium Stadium in Cardiff next Saturday. Back to see the two teams arrive in a few moments. Don't go away. So this vast arena, Twickenham, set to erupt with the arrival of the two sides. We just noticed that Nick Mallett, the coach of the Springboks, is already out in the stand, so the players having some quiet moments to themselves as they prepare to come out onto the hallowed turf, the old cabbage patch. And we've just run into a couple of supporters from St Edmund's College in Canberra, the old school of Georgie Gregan, who has a big test today against Joost van der Vesthuizen, Nick Barjones.
There's no doubt, Gordon, there's going to be some really key matchups, but Joost van der Vesthuizen, he's one of the key players. He's a strike weapon for the Springboks. Gregan will be in his face all day trying to nullify him and then hopefully transferring the pressure onto Yanni De Beer.
Simon, you have been salivating at the prospect of this clash up front. Massive Springbok pack against the Aussie athletes.
Well, I think the good thing out there is there's a great deal of confidence that the South Africans are going to crush us in the forwards. They might get a surprise today. This Australian four-pack has been building this whole World Cup. I think the front row has certainly shown a lot of promise the last couple of weeks. And I do believe we've got a better line-out than South Africa. But we've got to watch Andre Venter. He is a key man at the back of the line-out for South Africa.
And Chris Handy down on the touchline, very close to the action. Lots of Australian fans here. What about Rod Moore coming onto the bench? That's an interesting one, Chris.
It is an interesting one, Gordon. What a surprise for him, what a delight. But it's difficult, I suppose, when you've not played a lot of international rugby to run on. And if they need him in the first 2 minutes, it's going to be a true test of whether he's got the goods. That surprised me, that move. I'd have thought Crowley or Glenn Panahoe, having had Super 12 and international experience, would get the nod. But they've stuck with Rod Moore, and that's a good support for him.
Yes, well, I suppose it's a case of who's going to face the 130-kilogram strongman, the ox, Os de Runt, as Joost van der Westhuizen comes out alongside Joe Rock. Joe Rock leading out the Wallaby team on this, the occasion of his 50th Test match. In 128 years of international rugby history, Joe Rock is the youngest man ever and the shortest time ever to reach 50 caps, beating Jeff Wilson's mark by just 3 months. So the two sides are now out on the field in their tracksuits, warming up. They're getting ready for the anthems. And the surface here at Twickenham, absolutely sublime.
Interesting tactics, both sides. The Springbok forwards stayed inside. The Australians opted to come out and warm up as a team.
I think that will be advantageous for the Wallabies, experiencing these difficult wind conditions. This is going to be an enormous battle, a huge physical contest.
And given the wind out there, Percy Montgomery, one real weakness under the high ball, really got to use it against him today. Kefu, a huge game is required from him to obliterate Skinstad.
Well, Bobby Skinstad had his car accident 5 months ago. He ran into a wall and injured his knee. And that's been a real setback for him. He was in outstanding form in the Super 12, so he's still finding his way. There's Tim Horan. All eyes are on him this afternoon, hero from 91.
Yeah, he's got so much maturity, Tim, so brave. Obviously, he doesn't look as well as he normally does, looks very pale, but I bet he'll go as long as he can. Crucial figure in the midfield for Australia.
Well, the problem for Tim Horan is that he hasn't really been able to eat yesterday, so the nutritional build-up just hasn't been there. Dr. John Best, who is the man in charge on the medical side, has done a great job with the Wallabies, and they've really tried to give him the right nutrition this morning to really beef him up.
And you can be sure that Peter Muller, who's his opponent, will be running at him all day. He really is the blockbusting centre that the South Africans use to try and get over the game line.
But people who know Tim Horan know how mentally tough the guy is. He's been through a lot of pain to get himself back to the form he's in. He's a fantastic person.
So the two sides lining up as we stand by for the anthems. And Advance Australia Fair will be sung by John Williamson. So well done, John Williamson, who had a concert here in London on Thursday night. And now the South African fans have their moment, their special moment with the Springbok players. DJ Powers on the left, St. Paul Union in 1995.
Oh,
It's payback time for the colonies. It's a foreign invasion here at Twickenham as the pyrotechnic display begins and the two sides go into a huddle. Well, Chris Handy, you're escorting a tour around Britain, Ireland, and also France. As we look at the two lineups, I'll come back to you in a moment. But this South African team, the same starting lineup that took the field against England. South African record for prop Os de Runt, 38 cap. Andre Venter sets a new record for a flanker, he's 39th cap. Mark Andrews is the test cap record holder with 60 today. Joost van der Westhuizen, the skipper, has 29 test match tries from his 56 internationals. So a very impressive looking South African lineup. Honeyball's on the bench, we're expecting to see him in the second half. Horan has come out of his sickbed for the Aussies. Joe Roth, a milestone 50th cap today, 53rd for George Gregan. In the pack, Kefu is back after suspension. John Eales plays only his fourth test match this year. Quiet achiever David Giffen steps out for his 15th international. 628 caps in this very experienced Australian lineup. So Chris, a lot of parents, a lot of family here today for the Wallabies.
Yeah, fabulous day. Jason Little's mum and dad, Rod Caper's mum and dad, they're not on the field, but they're as much part of it as any. And Global and other people have got enormous amounts of people here from Australia, all who met yesterday, to the tones of John Williamson, who sang that wonderful anthem, and also Vince Cerretti entertaining everyone royally. In fact, that function was at the South African Hotel, so we've already struck the first blow in the psychological war.
And it's good to see the Wallaby mascot has produced since you were here in 1991, Nick Barjones.
Yeah, it's been a happy stamping ground, Twickenham, for the Australians. Central player there. Will he be going for the long drop goals, Chris? Is the wind favouring the Wallabies or is it swirling?
It is swirling, but it's favouring the Wallabies. But Yanni De Beers on there because of that long-range shot. But they've got Henry Honeyball waiting in the wings, and that man is a defensive unit and is a good ball runner. So they call him Mlem. Short of Afrikaans for Blade. He cuts through them like a knife.
Well, huge focus on De Beer this week, but Steve Larkham, he's the man, the Australian side, to lead him through the gaps. Very strong Springbok defence, very strong Australian defence. George Gregan will have a very key role on targeting De Beer on those drop goals.
So the final seconds before blast-off, Stephen Larkham. Such a key man in the Australian side. We think the Wallabies will have some wind assistance in this first half, but as Chris mentioned, it is swirling around. It's a treacherous breeze and expected to intensify during the afternoon. So Derek Bevan there, the man in the middle, the 51-year-old. He's an electrical training officer with BP, officiating in his fourth World Cup. He had the World Cup final between Australia and England here in 1991.
You see the wind is very strong, and Matthew Burke's now got assistance from Daniel Herbert to line the ball up for the kickoff, a critical kickoff for the Wallabies.
You can see that flag wrapped around the post. That's how the wind is changing. Continually moves around at the top of the stadium.
Australians go short. Picked up there by Crano Otto and De Beer. Matthew Burke on the 22. 5 metres in from that touchline. He returns to Percy Montgomery. Montgomery back downfield into the breeze. Here's Horan. He got a good bounce.
The Australians have to be very careful not to fall in the trap that the English did in Paris 1 week ago. You don't take the South Africans on at the kicking game.
Yeah, that was a surprising kick from Matthew Burke. Went straight to Montgomery. Montgomery, open field, just plugged it in the corner here.
Michael Foley getting his line-out organised. This will be crucial. Marking up on Eales. They know he's the man that the money ball goes to.
Well, I don't think they'll be going to six in defence with this wind.
Here's the decoy, taking Crane Otto away. Andrew's an expert at two as well.
Andrews is marking David Giffen here. Giffen goes. Giffen comes away. Eales. And pass straight to Venter. He's brought down by Wilson. Van der Westhuizen Erasmus in behind again. Matthew Burke, little time. Gets in a good reply. And the bounce.
Fantastic reflexes there from Kepu to get that splitted ball. Got to Fields, and Fields clearly Fetter's call for the ball there. Smart work from Fetter. Set up the South African drive into the corner, but Matthew Burke saves the day.
Well, Gordon, you called it a good kick. It was an exceptional kick. He was hard on defence. Erasmus tried to play Burke into the corner to get a line out. But they've got right down, and that's the South African 22 there.
Peter is so not looking comfortable wandering back into position.
Otto again. Big drive from the box. They've gone 15 metres. Wallaby's caught napping there. Foley the tackler, just short of halfway. De Beer. Under Vesthuizen hesitated there. Aussies ruled offside.
Well, all week this Australian forward pack would have been thinking, get De Beer. Got too enthusiastic then, got in front of the referee. They got him, but all to no avail.
Yeah, De Beer will know he's got gold jerseys all over him. It was Larkin first, Kepu came, Richard Harry was in there.
So De Beer is going to have a shot from goal. His own side of halfway. No score. Yes, well, Van der Vesthuizen really hesitated. The ball was out of that ruck. And I think he'd be feeling very fortunate to snare that penalty. Yanni De Beer. 55 metres out. No way. That's two-thirds. John Eales. Matthew Burke. Just a low trajectory, not quite the distance he wanted, 38 metres out from the Wallaby goal line.
Interesting, all sides down this World Cup of placing their big jumpers underneath the goal post to try and cut off the ball if it comes close to the crossbar.
The Wallabies have to decide whether they're either going to defend the rolling ball, which we saw the South Africans use so effectively, or try and compete for the ball in the air.
Skinstad at the back. Beautifully to Andrews. Harry got him. 25 to go. Under Vesthuizen, Eales the tackler. Penta. South Africa going straight through the middle of the Wallaby pack. Skinstad, Fleck. Loose pass, Larkham. Stephen Larkham and Horan. Rothers there behind him. The chase on. Roth quick over. De Beer. The kick in. What drama!
What great play from Tim Horan. Remember in the World Cup final of 91, it was a retrieve in defence and then a kick ahead that led to the try by Daly. Well up the line. Look at this. Tim Horan knew he didn't have the gas in the tank. Chipped ahead and put De Beer under pressure.
And what a fabulous chase from Larkham. Really caught De Beer. Now the line-up, the Australians.
Cobain at the back. Wallaby's very close here. 7 metres out. There's John Eales and Gregan. Larkham.
Horan.
He's wrapped up in close. 8 metres out from the Springbok goal line. Larkham drop. He's put it wide.
Well, Steve will realise that he's missed a wonderful opportunity. Only 15 metres out, straight in front. It was a good option. He only had two gold jerseys outside him.
Now, why he did that, I don't know. He was carrying a cork thigh. Look at him limping there. He has to go onto his left foot to kick right-footed. And clearly, he wasn't balanced.
Here's Burke. Good bounce. Burke picked it up. 35 out. Horan. It's Daniel Herbert. Narka Drotsky was there with Erasmus. Regan wants it. Penalty Australia within kicking range.
Larkham down in back play. It's not a good sign. He really was caught badly.
Much smarter option there from Matthew Burke. Just dropped it in behind. Beautifully weighted.
There's certainly plenty of action with this Wallaby team. Look at the drive at the breakdown. They realise this is crucial. This is where they've got to drive the green jerseys backwards. Gregan applauding. Chance for 3 points. First points.
So Stephen Larkham, a has received a knock on his leg. And as Chris mentioned, it looks like a cork. It's worrying him at the moment. Greg Craig is there, the miracle worker for the Wallaby team, who was with the squad in 1991. And Matthew Burke lining up 25 metres out.
Not a great sign. Stephen Markham obviously concerned. He's back to his feet. Not confident on his left foot, and that's the one that takes all the weight when he's wanting to use the right foot to kick.
Well, the dilemma is that Larkin comes off, Horan go to fly half, and he's already a little bit weak from his stomach illness.
Tim Horan here holding the ball, and a strong win for Matthew Burke.
Larkin still walking gingerly. Can Matthew Burke land the first points? He struck it beautifully, but not good enough. Wind just taking that away to the left. You got excited with that one, Nick.
Well, I did, Gordon. From where I'm looking at the monitor, that looked like it was going through to me. Points won't be easy to come by. Probably the two best defensive units in the world.
De Beer over Burke's head. Now Joe Rock. Raking kick there from Yanni De Beer. Roth needs a big one here. We spoke too soon. 35 metres out.
Simon, it's obvious that South Africa are going to make it difficult for us to secure two-handed ball, but what would you be doing? Defending the ball, or would you be going for this South African ball to pinch one?
Well, I'd be splitting the options there, Nick. We've got to do both.
Back to Drotsky. Clever variation from the Springboks. Scrum half actually winning that line-out ball. De Beer then. Grubbers through. He's Herbert and Burke. Hinter lost it backwards. Rousseau. Wallaby defence regroups. Rousseau looking for support. Australia form out on the left. Robbie Fleck. Oster run. Thunder Vestizen drop goal. Yanni De Beer. And he's put it wide.
Well, he didn't miss one in Paris. Five drop goals from five attempts. He was practicing before the game, but it's not easy out there. Plenty of pressure, limited time and space. This was, so we see Timmy Horan charging through.
This was the perfect time to have a drop goal. They forced the South African attack wide. Rousseau had come back inside, they were disorganised. Van der Vestizen went straight back to De Beer, and that was the chance.
Burke goes straight down the centre of the field, over De Beer's head. He's 10 from halfway. Huge kick. Will it go dead in goal? Right back, thank you, on the other side of halfway.
Also, George Gregan on that last De Beer drop goal right through on top of him. He's got to do it the whole game. Way too much room last week against England.
This is where Australia will be looking to take out the back row of South Africa. Erasmus on the side, number six. Will Kefu be the man?
Australian scrum rock solid. Here's Herbert. Not quite to the advantage line. Gregan now for Burke. Overlap out here for Australia. Tune. 15 metres to go. Gregan gets quick ball. Horan. Larkham. Kefu's behind him. So is Richard Harry. Gregan again. Interference from the box. Another penalty.
You've got to say professional foul. That situation. I'd much rather them have a shot at goal than struggle in defence. Leaning over, quite clearly standing over the top. What a great move by Burke. He got in behind that defence, bumped off the other one that came from Montgomery, and Tune, on his own, beat a couple, set the ball up. And then they punched again midfield. It's good play from the Aussies, and when it broke down, here Larkin nearly squeaked through, set the ball. They reach over the top. Mark Andrews, look at him.
So Matthew Burke almost out in front here with this penalty attempt and surely he will put this one through.
We've been waiting the whole tournament for Matthew Burke to hit that line, hit that line just with so much acceleration that time round. Beautiful ploy. We'd have liked to see Derek Bevan play a little more advantage there.
Well, what we are seeing is that this breeze is fluctuating and it really is swirling. One moment it favours one side, then the other. He's got that one. First points for the Wallabies in the Rugby World Cup semi-final 1999, Australia 3-0.
Simon, you're dead right. The speed and the straight running that Burke hit that breakdown from, it was all very simple play from the Wallabies, but it was certainly constructed. We saw the ball from Larkham to Burke, created ball.
Yanni De Beer with the restarts. Eels is there. Andre Fenter came through. Richard Harry's gone in to rip it here, just outside the quarter. Burke's going to have a kick. No, it's Larkham. Big purchase on that one. Rousseau, 10 from halfway. Nicely weighted kick, holding up in the breeze. Larkham's inside his quarter. And he calls for the mark. Spiral torpedo. He wants a banana. This is Percy Montgomery. Joe Roth underneath. Good technique. They're going down the left. Roth doesn't want it to go dead. The ball holds up. Yanni De Beer, good chase from Joe Roth. And in touch just outside the corner.
Well, Montgomery won't be happy with that kick. Centre field to Joe Roth. No one deep and right for South Africa. Roth, great vision to put Australia on attack.
And good work by Larkham. Montgomery's got to go off his left foot, so have very little room down this touchline.
Look at that great, those great pictures from up on high, seeing the Australian backline set up. Larkham looks as though he's settled down. Short line out option.
Heels at the back, comfortably. Gregan and Larkham. Kefu's out here in midfield. Into De Beer and Fleck. He's Gregan again, numbers for Australia. Burke, lovely little flick pass from Larkham. Through Gregan's legs. Larkham in a spot of bother. Skinstad comes through. Australia going forward, but the referee has ruled that it was a maul, a collapse maul, and lost opportunity.
Well, let's watch closely here. George Gregan, they're all over him at the breakdown. Larkham put under huge pressure, but he did retrieve the ball.
So the score here, 3-0 in favour of the Wallabies. We've just seen Andrew Blades having some attention. There's Dick Mallett, caps in 1984 for the Springboks against Spain, celebrating his 43rd birthday today. So Andrew Blades having some attention, Chris Handy, facing Oz Durant.
Yeah, this is the time when the eyeballs start quivering good, and this is pressure time, trying to manipulate that Springbok scrum. See how they're trying to drive it sideways so they don't get balanced ball to get back to De Beer or Percy Montgomery.
Montgomery gets it, and a hurried kick. Here's Burke. Athletic skills from the fullback. He tells Tune to follow. Coming down to De Beer. Only 10 metres from that touchline. De Beer goes for distance. Roth again. So Roth might have a little run here. Stephen Larkham and Kefu. Kick just a little too far. Montgomery. Good play, Australia.
Yeah, Australia certainly showing that they're prepared to play an expansive game. Good conditions apart from the wind. One expects them to go wide. And certainly Joe Roth backing Larkham out wide. Larkham finding Kefu, the short chip in the chase. Importantly, crucially, Australia throwing to the line-out.
There's great composure in the decision-making out there by all players, whether it be forwards or backs. It's excellent.
I think the thing that stands out is already Australia are playing a far smarter game than England did. England got enough ball to beat the Springboks, but they didn't do anything with it.
Here's Larkin and Tune coming in from the right wing. He was manhandled by the Ox. David Wilson went into scrum half. Larkin into the forwards. Wallabies bustled off the ball there. And then they backchecked.
Well, it's just great defence there from Bobby Skinstad. Really nailed Larkin. All went wrong from there.
It's the crux of the South African game, that physical presence in the tackle. They were able to turn over more than 10 possessions that England took in last weekend.
Well, a couple of times we've seen some badly controlled ball from the forwards to scrum half Regan, and that's put the Australian backs under pressure.
Australians against Wales, 19 turnovers, way too high. It's been pretty good so far, but you don't give too many opportunities to the Springboks.
Look at that great picture from above, showing both the back line setups.
This is Erasmus. De Beers going for a drop again, and he's pulled that one. Well, if he's been having some very pleasant dreams this week, it's turning into a nightmare for Yanni with two attempts.
Well, everyone he misses is a lost opportunity for scoring points from the Springboks. The Australians are using this win well, so getting out of this danger zone.
In fact, that one came off Stephen Larkin. An arm going up there, such as the close marking on De Beer.
Perfect game, straight down to Montgomery. 15 from the halfway line. He goes back up the centre, but he's chasing hard with Dion Kayser. Kefu underneath. Tonai Kefu, all forwards. Scrambles across the turf. Offside play. Anxious moments there for the Wallaby defence against Mark Andrews.
You watch most rucks and mauls out there. Mark Andrews will be hanging on the side, just working that offside line. That time, way too enthusiastic.
He's always offside, Mark Andrews. He just comes in late. Tries to follow through as the ball goes back, but
you're right, Buddha, always being polite.
Of course, you were never offside, Buddha, were you?
No. Just loitering. Good to see Mac Burke playing confidently. He's kicking confidently, he's looking sharp, he's running hard at the ball and doing things quickly, and that's a great sign, a sign that he's back on song.
Fly half so far, Larkham's played past five times out of eight. De Beers kicked every time at five.
Big throw up the back to Eels. Off Springbok legs, Gregan. Good refereeing there as he played the advantage. Stephen Larkin, not a good kick, lost a head.
Well, we got lucky there. Jus van der Vesthuizen normally so safe with the hands. He realised he had an opportunity out wide, but I really don't know what Larkin was trying to do there. I think the execution was poor. It was meant to go further downfield.
The referee has ruled that one a charge down, so he's having a line-out for the kick-out on the full, but I think it was clearly lost ahead. Should have been a scrum for Australia.
In front of this eyes and certainly trying to catch the ball.
Cobain did well in the line-out. Here's Horan. Lovely step. Timmy Horan. Wilson is there. Can the Wallabies finish here? Springboks all offside. Professional foul again. The try was on.
De Beer, a shocker. Watch him run through in front of his pass. He's not a slow lumbering forward, he's a fast back.
Well, the speculation up to yesterday was that Horan was not going to play. But have a look at this play. The speed, the determination through the gap. And very importantly here, Tim could have gone for a speculative pass, but he held on to the possession. Control is everything today.
If that's Tim Horan sick, I'd love to see it when he's fit and well. Very focused.
3-0 Australia. Matthew Burke with 463 test points. He's got a long way before he catches Michael Liner's 911. 448 to go.
With the Springboks in behind, they're not happy about a few things. Skinstad, the number 8, screaming at his players. Good sign for Australia.
Thank you. Second penalty goal for Matthew Burke. Straight through the high diddle-diddle. Australia 6, South Africa 0 in this do-or-die semi-final.
Last week in Paris, the English attack really didn't test this Springbok defence. Wallaby's done a lot of work on the defensive line this week. They can see some holes out there, and are they working it?
Yeah, they've been very clever in their preparation. They're using blindside wingers, using Horan, Regan directing it well.
De Beer allows Andrews to come through, and he tackles David Gifford, who stands his ground. Markham standing back inside the 22. Left foot. Spiral torpedo. Peter Rousseau. Montgomery wants it. Angle to touch. Joe Roth gets a favourable bounce. Here's Montgomery again. He's quick. Skins that brought down in Australian territory. Pazer goes into scrum half. Rousseau at fly half, spots a gap. Gifford got him. With a 10-metre line. Interference by the Australians. Well, David Wilson penalised.
They should have learnt the lesson last week, the Australians, at the ruck and maul last week, 11 penalties against them. This time he's got Dave Wilson.
No way in the world this was in from the side. Derek Bevan was in the bar last night until midnight, and he was on the wrong side of the maul. He came in as part of the dynamic play and came through it. The ball was available. He was on his feet.
Well, maybe, Chris, the ball was in there and a ruck or maul had formed there. So once that happens, if it's a maul, you're fine. If it was otherwise. Yeah, I think he was only having a nightcap, and he almost turned into a pumpkin.
Conservative nature of the African South African game so far really is kicking in the corners, waiting for the errors from the Australians. Here's one opportunity out of it.
Yanni De Beer, he's got the distance. Oh yes, Australia is punished for its indiscretion. The sun comes through at Twickenham. Yardies on the board, so is South Africa, 6-3.
Australians swapping sides here, moving to the to their right. Again, putting the pressure on the South African kickers on the return.
Well, the Wallabies have played the rugby here so far, but their lead is only 3 points on the scoreboards. Burke goes shallow, Andrews underneath. Wrestled to ground and driven backwards. Wallabies have pitched it. Very good technique there by the Australian tacklers.
Oh, beautiful work. They waited till Andrews got to ground. They mauled him down, turned him, did not release. Matthew Burke, another opportunity. Listen to the referee.
Well, Matt Cobain pinned Andrews. It was a beautiful move. Takes all the strength to do this. Look at him down. He and Kefu, and then Cobain stops him from coming back to his own side, and then they panic. Can't get the ball back. He holds on.
So put that penalty down to John Muggleton, the defensive coach for the Wallabies. It's 6-3. Wallabies playing very confidently. Defence has been swarming. Burke would dearly love to slot this one for the Army of Australian fans and his side. The croquet skills were on during the week, and so is that golden boot. Australia 9-3.
A lot of pressure there on the management. They know they're 55 minutes away from a trip down to Cardiff.
Rod Kafer sitting there with Rod McQueen. He's been part of the Wallaby Brains Trust. As Larkham now, only 10 from his goal line. Here's Rousseau. Loves to run. Four tries against the French at Parc des Princes. back in 97. Erasmus off his right foot. Punched by Wilson and Cobain. Osterhunt. They got him quickly, but he just got over the advantage line. Kick's gone straight up. Brissot put into touch.
Well, South Africa's struggling at the breakdown. The real beauty of the Australian recycling is it's been quick. South Africa just getting slow ball back to Van der Westhuizen.
It feels like that South Africa have been taken out of their comfort zone and they're really struggling for options. And that's a good sign. That means the pressure of the Wallaby defence has forced them into this uncomfortable position.
So they must settle if they're to build against the Wallabies. And the boot's on the other foot for the box.
David Giffen, cleverly. Here's Cobain. Defence was waiting. Andre Venter. Gregan. Wanted that one to go towards the touchline. It did. Look at the tackle! And it came off a Wallaby defender. Well, South Africa played quickly. It had to be the same ball. Derek had his back turned and they caught him by surprise.
That happened right in front of us and that ball went into touch off Brissot. It had already crossed the line. The Wallabies arguing the toss. Derek Bevan saying it was touched in flight. Had nothing to do with that.
No, I think it did come off a yellow defender, Chris, but we'll agree to disagree on that one. Skipstats. Wilson around his ankles. Under Westhuizen to the Ox. Larkin bounced off him that time. Mark Andrews in at scrum half. Good tackle by Eels. The big men collide.
Look who's in the pocket.
Under Westhuizen. He threw the big dummy and then didn't find a support. Burt was in the last line. There was no one else there for Australia. Skinstad again. Gregan up for the tackle. Two. Roth got it. Now it's back to Erasmus and Giffen pitched it. Wallabies may be out of jail. Venter came through quickly. Great play, South Africa.
What drama, Gordon. They went so close with Erasmus reclaiming the ball. Had he found off the run on the inside, it was a short try. But the Wallabies clinging on. Just when I thought the South Africans were looking very one-dimensional, it was their captain, Van der Westhuizen, who went through and created all this pressure for the Wallabies.
We'll call that a knock-on from Stephen Larkham, and the pressure now builds on the Wallabies as they feed this Springbok scrum.
Two on two. Muller went himself and has driven back in the tackle. Van der Westhuizen again. The Ox knocked on. Eels somehow got his boot to it. Here's Horan. He pitched it. Wilson. Burke. It's Herbert. He wants support. Near halfway. Gregan now. Larkin calls for it. Kepu's there. He's Roth. It was a bad pass from the number eight. Roth's soccer skills come to play. Kayser got it. De Beer fumbled. Now Montgomery has a run. Play on, says the referee. Penta, this is the time to go for South Africa. Pass was forward.
Oh, how much drama's out here. It's going all over the place. Great rugby in a big game like this. The sign on the stand says, J.S. Joseph Ward, Cosmos Rock. Go, you good little soccer band. And the Wallabies, that pass had have gone to hand. They'd have had the box stretched. It's scrambling defence by both teams.
So, what excitement. What a cracker here at Twickenham. Australia, 9-3. Deep breaths all round there as Mark Connor's getting ready to come on. One of the heroes against the All Blacks at Stadium Australia. David Giffen got a heavy knock. I love that little tuft of hair coming through the headgear. Nice arrangement.
Smart work from Van der Westhuizen. He really stood De Beer back when he got that gap. So the Australians were watching De Beer way back in the pocket. Van der Westhuizen saw them looking at him, went through. Big ground.
Giffen's nickname is 60 Minutes because he's had a lot of injuries. Van der Westhuizen coming through. Kepu made 8 metres. Gregan now. Burke for Joe Roth. Here's Montgomery. He counters, and well. Wallabies won't be happy about that tactic.
They'd be happy about the way Kefu took the ball to back the scrum. Thunderfist highs and all over him. Picked it up well, drove. Now, line out throw. Must be good. Look at that flag going over there. The wind bursting down the field.
Australia doing so well with the ball in hand, Nick. It's strange to see them kick it away, even to advance the position.
Yeah, Chris, they've been very clever with use of ball in hand.
John Eels. Markham. Good pass from Regan. Herberts charging onto the ball. They're well over the advantage line. Regan again. Stephen Larkham wanted to get it over Montgomery's head. Montgomery with plenty of time for the reply. Big distance, Larkham near the quarter. No one really chasing except Montgomery there. Rousseau's outside his quarter. Here comes Horan. He got him. Andrews. Great defence from Eels. Sprinboks on the short side here. And now De Beer, just to settle things down.
Well, the box know that they're in a game. They're really having to think this one out, and it's usually off the back foot. And often they've got that ball to carry forward, and they're so powerful going forward.
Really good communication then from Horan to Larkham. Said, put the ball up. Timed his run through on the fullback.
Horan's been outstanding. First 30 minutes of this game, he's been everywhere. Foley's got to get this ball on the money.
Wallaby forwards have moved the big bok pack around here in the first half. Larkham again, and Horan. Skinstad on his back. Perfect setup from Horan. Larkham. Thunder Vestheisen waiting for that grubber. Erasmus now. Montgomery on the counter. Fleck. Straight to Roth. Under pressure. Horan. Trouble. Gregan. They scramble. Wallaby's in control. And a little knock on. They got over inches there.
Well, it's tense out there, George Gregan. How well did he cover that error from Timmy Horan? Watch him go and just drives from this breakdown. Almost breaks away, and then the turnover.
And those 2 or 3 metres were crucial.
De Beer standing on the short side. 4 on 3. Here's Burke. Soccer skills. Tim, you were offside.
But I don't think Derek got it. No, he did, of course. Kick, he says. Horan in front.
Well, Matthew Burke used to sleep with his soccer ball when he was 7 years old. I don't think he would have been happy with that fly kick.
Well, Tim doesn't look happy there, but I really don't know what got into him.
Well, I think he maybe felt, Nick, that it came off a South African player, but the referee said no.
Well, how about this stat? De Beers had 6 possessions. He's kicked every time. Larkham's had 17. He's passed on 9 occasions. The expansive game he's in. He's run twice. Let's watch it.
There's no doubt at all the tactics of the Wallabies is to go for the quick recycle, to get the continuity, and to move the big bot forwards around.
I don't think I've ever seen them, Nick, move the ball as quickly from the line-out. They're not fiddling around there. Eels is just pushing the ball to Gregan, and they're getting it wide before the defence gets there.
But for all their dominance in this first half, the margin could be just 3 points Australia's way if this one goes over. He's got the distance again. 9-6. De Beer gets his 2nd penalty goal.
Well, given the way the wind's now starting to move down the field with the Springboks, this wouldn't be a bad result. Close to half time, about 3 points in it.
Well, just to sit here and look around the crowd, amount of green and gold. I know a lot of it's South Africa, but it's a rare change to red jerseys of Cardiff.
Andrews lost ahead. Australia has it. playing in good advantage, Derek Bevan. Hurts! Horan went without it. Play on. Rousseau. Big hit! Matt Cobain. That was a cruncher. Mark Andrews standing out in midfield. Loose ball there for Fleck. Just caught by Kepu around the collar. We're on halfway. De Beer. Roff's there. The ball went dead touch and goal, but Australians were all loitering offside. Tim Horan was caught behind the play there. Penalty, South Africa.
2.5 minutes to half-time. Van der Westhuizen asking the referee, will De Beer have a shot for goal?
I don't think he's got the legs from there, Simon, but what they could do, of course, is go for line-out to get down around 30 metres out. And I wouldn't be surprised to see them try and drive a possession from a line-out with De Beer in behind for the drop goal.
So De Beer gets the touch, 37 metres out. Very close to half-time now. 1.5 remaining.
Springboks slow to come in. Will they try and drive the Wallabies back to put De Beer in range? Or will they go for the quick shift with Skinstad and Erasmus out in De Beer's pocket?
I think if you see the two players out in his pocket, looks like they may use them centre field, been able to get penetration otherwise.
David Giffen pinched it. What a steal. He specialises in that sort of timing. Such a vital line-out win. Erasmus was up very quickly there. Regan again, looking for the cycle ball. Here's Horan. Tune. And Rousseau knocked on.
Really good thought in that line-out from the Australians, especially Giffen. Fedder was standing out at halfback. He was obviously going to get the ball. They stacked around that gap in the line-out and picked it beautifully.
The Wallabies know the most crucial thing is to get in behind the Springboks. They've used the chip kick very effectively.
Van der Westhuizen's been ruled offside. He sweats on that offside line. And the referee said, Joost, you were premature.
Now time for Burke to think. Probably the kick into the corner again and see if they can use it a little better. Kicking against this wind.
And the touch down near the 22, trying to cancel on this side. So this may well be the last set piece of this first half.
The Wallabies from the set piece have been very effective in creating a ruck possession, centre field, and then bringing it back to short side with players like Burke hitting the gain line.
Kepu in Larkham's pocket.
Matt Cobain and Bregan. Wilson. Horan picked up a loose pass. Here's Bregan again and Larkham. Took the right option there. There's a penalty for Australia.
Stupid play, Springboks straight in front.
Referee's playing advantage. Jose Crano Otto came through. Australia dearly wants the penalty, but maybe they could give a try. Has the advantage finished? Herbert and Foley. He's taking it back for the penalty.
Yeah, very good refereeing, Bevan. Realised that this is almost a certain 3 points for Burke straight in front.
It's good to see the Wallabies go for it then. They've got nothing to lose, and now they've got the penalty up their sleeve and just drive and try and get a gap.
Crano Otto took the soft option. He rolled in over in the ruck. Larkham takes it forward. Watch for Jersey. Slides in around, there he is, four, and allows himself to fall over the ball. You can't do it.
He needed a good shredding from there.
Yeah. It used to happen. It doesn't anymore. We miss it.
Yes. I'm not so sure, Chris.
We halfbacks don't miss it, Nick. So Matthew Burke.
Prepare for the worst.
Well, I don't know what Derek's talking about. Maybe there's some bad weather on the way. So he's breathing a lot easier, or more easy today, Derek Bevan. Really getting around the field extremely well for a 51-year-old. makes it almost be the half-time score at 12-6, which was the full-time score in 1991 in the World Cup final, Australia over England. Confirmed by Matthew Burke. A famous scoreboard at half-time. Australia leading 12-6. No tries in the match, but Matthew Burke certainly right on the target, getting four penalty goals, Yanni De Beer two. Half-time at Twickenham. Semi-final, Australia 12, South Africa 6. Back shortly. And our Qantas postcard this week features Rugby School, where that precocious English schoolboy picked up the ball in a soccer game and ran with it early in the last century. William Webb Ellis's grave now rests in France. So there's the scene at the home of rugby, Twickenham. And what an enthralling first half we've seen in this World Cup semi-final between Australia and South Africa. The half-time score favouring the Wallabies by 12 points to 6. Well, Nick, I think we're catching our breath. That was very quick.
It was a great half, and I really think Australia was the most creative team. Unlike England last week, they've really thought about how to get in behind South Africa. And I think the tactics will work and favour them in the second 40 minutes. Mallard will be looking for some strategic replacements, because I really think the way the Australians are moving around the big Springbok forwards, Gordon, they might run out of a bit of steam.
Some real innovation there, Simon, for the Wallabies in getting in behind the Springboks in the first half.
Yeah, but they had the courage to throw it wide, and they've found some gaps in close as well. They've really thought about this game this week, and this is a good Springbok defence, but they've found plenty of holes out there.
Yes, and De Beer, the man of the moment last week with his five drops, not to be so far.
Well, before the game he was hitting them very sweetly, but it really is the pressure that has been created. When I thought they were one-dimensional, it was this man. He's by far and away the most dangerous player for the Springboks. Their captain, Yus van der Westhuizen. They went so close from this breakdown. They brought it out left. It came to Russo. You see Skinstad screaming for the ball. The little chip through. Watch Erasmus. He actually gathers it. The ball was inside to Osterrand, but it went astray and the Wallabies survived.
Yes, David Giffen there, and George Gregan, I think, has the kick charts down. This was so close as well, Simon.
It was. Fender right on top of Larkham there. And let's see. Van der Westhuizen at Eels clears this one here. And the Australian chasing today has been fantastic. Any ball that's gone through, there's been two or three Wallabies there really putting pressure on them.
Well, I think Tim Horan should spend a lot more time in his sickbed, because he has been on fire in that first half, showing all of his great experience and enthusiasm out there as we look at those first half stats with Simon Poitevin.
Well, the interesting thing is we had 20 possessions out there, so we should have had more points on the board. The Springboks had seven and basically kicked them all away. Penalties running slightly in favour of the Springboks. Line-out is working very well. Only five scrums, and Larkham is using the ball extremely well.
And looking at the scoreboard, Matthew Burke, well, all that croquet practice during the week, I think, has really paid off for him. His concentration, his timing has been right on the mark. Yanni De Beer, two penalty goals, 12-6, the half-time score. Well, Chris Handy, I know you've enjoyed that first half action. Australia has the advantage. Can they maintain it in the second 40?
Well, good, and there are holes there, and they are out wide. Andrew Blades has done a marvellous job on Osterrand. I think they'll bring on Ollie LaRue quickly, and I think we'll see Henry Honnebull on as well, because they just have no options, the South Africans, in attack. Yanni De Beer is kicking the ball away. Such is the pressure of the Wallaby offensive defence.
Well, if you've had the kettle on, pour the tea. We'll be back in a few minutes, and you're going to enjoy a fantastic second half of football here at Twickenham. Back shortly. We've just seen the kickoff. Australia caught inside the quarter, and Burke's kick is charged down. Okay, Yanni De Beer again waits the kick. Here's Matthew Burke.
Well, that's a very composed start from the Wallabies. Excellent kickoff from the Springboks. They contained it, sent it downfield. Burke's now cleared. And a big kick.
The options for the Wallabies are there. but they don't want to be playing it in their half. They feel this is the only area that De Beer is able to strike. It'll be interesting to see whether they kick it out of their territory or they carry it out. I think they'll carry it out.
Just short of the halfway line, Australia's territory. Mark Andrews, nicely timed jump at the front. And Skinstad gets low for the drive. Johnny Ills tries to stem the tide. Springboks get some momentum here. Kefu read it. Almost to the 10-metre line. They're going to work it in close. Giffen in for the tackle with Cobain. Oster runs. Two men to stop him. Van der Vesthuizen with a bit of space. Tune. Slow reaction. Wallaby still there. Now Gregan looking for Larkham. No, it comes out for South Africa. Drotsky. Bobby Fleck into scrum half. Foley with a big tackle. They send him backwards. Van der Vesthuizen short sides. Australia squats on the Springbok captain. Defence is holding at the moment. Oz de Runtz back into the teeth of the Wallaby pack. Now they go through the middle. Back through the legs it comes. Yanni De Beer, drop goal is charged down by Herbert. He's been ruled offside.
Well, it looks exciting, but we're going back for a penalty. 15 metres from the Australian line.
The players haven't heard the whistle.
Such is the noise in this cauldron. And Derek Bevan says offside. I don't know whether he's got a call from the touch judge. Herbert. May not have been Herbert that was offside. He certainly charged out what looked like one that was going through the post.
Yeah, no, it wasn't Herbert, Chris. The penalty's been awarded. Where South Africa were trying to splinter the Australian defensive in close around the rucks.
Number six.
I heard number 14 mentioned there by the referee, Erasmus as well.
Tell me that's the Joe. End of it. Okay. That's the end of it. Good. Same decision, same penalty.
That man Erasmus said Australia cannot win the World Cup. He said that during the Tri Nations. We shall see.
Well, it seemed to be quite strong discipline from the Wallabies down there. Derek Bevan was keeping a very close guard there, talking to him.
No change to the halftime score, 12-6 to the Wallabies. Well, a supercharged start to the second half by the Springboks. Camp down in Australian territory, now the opportunity to convert that pressure on the scoreboard. No problem for Yanni De Beer, 3 points the difference. The world champions are closing.
Talking to former Springbok captain Mars Boyder, the great fly half before the match, he was speculating that Mallett would bring on Henry Honeyball to replace this man. But the way the scores are and how good a kicker he is, I can't see that happening.
Well, the goal-kicking duties would either be with Honeyball or Percy Montgomery, if that happens. So Australia by just three. This wins all over the place. Van der Vesthuizen, the inspirational skipper to Erasmus, who captained the Springboks against the Wallabies. Montgomery got a nice kick in there. Matthew Burke. And Ben Tune was inside the 10 metres in front of the kicker. Referee plays advantage. Tune interfered there with the South Africans. That's a penalty.
Just got to make sure that this discipline remains the Wallabies. The Springboks play a physical game and they play for territory. Trying to get this man into range to score points. It has to be discipline from the Wallabies.
We saw it from a similar position here. About 2 minutes back, they just drove the ball forward, got field position. Opted for an hour, three-man line-out. Andrews, the jumper.
taken by Andrews, De Beer, Peter Muller, the battering ram, caught by Wilson. Is that a little knock back there by Van der Vesthuizen? Drotsky's caught. Stephen Larkham threw on him. Osterunt leaves it now for Van der Vesthuizen. Montgomery looking for territory. He drills it. So Burke again. Well taken by Percy Montgomery. Ice cool nerves. Just on Australia's side of halfway.
Well, I'm not sure why the Australians didn't have a player there to field that kick.
Well, back to where it all began. Now the Australians have an opportunity to make some territory from here.
Got to keep that ball in hand and run it up over the line. They've forced the South Africans out of a comfortable zone that they've been in against the Poms. You've got to keep them there.
David Giffen. Now Larkham. Kefu. Big charge. They're in behind the South African defence. Interference on the ground there. Looks as though Osterunt has been penalised.
Beautiful ball there from Larkham. Took out Skinstad. Then Kefu had plenty of time to make room there, which he does. Spencer eventually gets onto him.
He's so effective. That body height low and the power. We see Richard Harry trying to clean out the possession. But Kefu, the main person to get over the game line.
Still 12-9 to the Wallabies. So Matthew Burke will be 47 metres out. He's directly in front. He's testing the strength of the breeze, and the grass actually blew back into his face there. But it's a lottery. Australia leading by just three. He's got the distance, but out to the right.
He certainly had the distance, struck that beautifully. These points are going to be so crucial. Two defensive units holding up to date.
De Beer looking for an advantage. Roth with good skills outside the quarter. Under Vesthuizen, over halfway. Now he has to release. Wilson pinched it. Traino came through. Wallaby scramble it back brilliantly. Larkham. Overlap for Tune.
Great pinch from David Wilson as we see Tune's kick a little off skew, going into touch along with Josh Cronfield, the All Black flanker. Wilson is the best in the business at that. Van der Vesthuizen got isolated. Wilson stayed on his feet, and before the ruck was formed, he was able to pinch it.
And then you see the power of that Springbok defense hit the breakdown. The Australians really did well to get it out of there.
Taken at the front by Durant. Another excellent variation from the Springboks. But the kicking boot of Yanni De Beer. Straight back to Matthew Burke. He's called for the mark.
Great variation by them in their lineouts, but nothing from De Beer. So few options in attack, and they're just clearly not going to play it out.
They only try to splinter Australia right through the middle, close to the rucks. Hugo Sturant's been one of those battering rams, but it is very one-dimensional from the Springboks.
Well, they had all the possession this second half. The ruck and maul count running at 14 to South Africa, 3 to the Australians. Now, can Giffen pitch on the ball here?
Marko Drotsky. Yanni De Beer again. Swarter kick. Tune. Well, he couldn't pick it up. Durant, he could. Quarter line ahead for the Springboks. Australia on their heels here. Van der Vesthuizen. De Beer goes for another drop goal. He hit it well. Scores a level.
Well, there you have it. Played out in spades. It came off the Wilson's hand. It doesn't matter at all. Just so long as it goes between the posts. Wilson was there. He knew it was on. De Beer, spot on.
It was his forwards that gave him the time and space, as they did against England. They just drove into the heart of the Wallabies, forcing them back. And it was the defensive unit of the Australians that was on the back foot that gave De Beer the space and gave him the 3 points.
Well, the Wallabies need full commitment to that loose ball. Has Burke gone out on the... No, he hasn't. Lost ahead by South Africa. But first off a gold arm.
It was Joe Ropp who came through, who leapt high, but unfortunately couldn't control the possession, knocking forward.
Difficult conditions underfoot, the two props just losing their footage. Has been a hard go on this side. Richard Harry doing strongly against Kobus Vasaki. For those two big packs. Springboks nearly 20 kilos heavier.
Johnny De Beer has now kicked 8 drop goals. 6 in a week.
Alan Finnegan warming up on the touchline. This is good Australian scrummaging.
Blades working on the run. Here's Peter Muller. Gregan with a good tackle out around the ankles. And now De Beer again. Nice kick. Down to the 22. Little Matthew Burke could do about that one. Yanni De Beer from Free States has put the box on the attack.
Well, they've had all the possession. Coach Nick Mallett sensing something good in the wind. All the possession, all the recycle. And it's given them a lot of possession and territory.
Burke did well then. And really almost got his foot to the ball. Would have been a Springbok throw-in.
Wallabies haven't been in this second half. 12-6 the score. South Africa have kicked 2 penalties to make it 12-all. They're attacking Australia here, but Giffen hauls it down to Gregan. And Kefu running from inside their quarter. Ball retention imperative here. Gregan. Kefu again with a big sidestep. Push the pass. Gregan with a huge tackle. Australia spoilt themselves there. The composure's just lacking at the moment.
Rasmus just taking the ball into Bevan. In that instance, Bevan has no option but to pull it up. The team that had the possession, the scrum feet. But good tactics from the Australians. They've got to keep ball in hand. They've got to be able to create some continuity. And it was Kefu initially that took it with the confidence out of their own 25.
Not in.
Pressure on up top. Really puts a lot of weight on those front 6 streaks.
What a cliffhanger here in the World Cup semi-final. It's deadlocked at 12-all. Van der Vesthuizen goes the short side. Skinstad. Van der Vesthuizen flicked it back to Kayser. Osterrunt came in.
Stay back foot.
Now De Beer again. Familiar tactic in the second half. Ben Tune. He follows. He wants the bounce. It goes to Montgomery. Fleck to De Beer. Rousseau. Burke in for the tackle. Van der Vesthuizen's pass and De Beer another drop attempt. He's pushed it out to the left. Back to the 22.
Cheering him. The crowd's cheering him. They realise these are the Springbok tactics to get points. They're not trying to create the continuity and going for the try. 1 from 4 drop goal attempts today.
It would be an easy team to coach, wouldn't it? If these were your tactics all the time. But
if the tactics, Chris, win them the semi-final.
That's exactly right, Gordon. You've got that follow-up if they win them. But
I'm with you, Buddha. And see the ball being squandered and play so marvellously in Super 12 and have a go.
Erasmus then, 10 from halfway. Cobain coming up. Foley, Andrews, straight into Johnny Ills. Well protected there by Mark Andrews. De Beer again. This time he goes wide to Skinstad. Herbert got him. Hislek finds some space. He's quick. He beat five or six tacklers. A great charge by Robbie Fleck. Australia hack it through. Here comes George Gregan. Dion Kayser there first. Good skills from him. South Africa drive their man forward to secure possession. Peter Rousseau. Australia interfered there at the breakdown. There's going to be a penalty against them. Percy Montgomery. Referee says the advantage has accrued. No, it hasn't. Here's the penalty.
He's got the Australians of being offside. Look like John Eales on the side of that mall.
There was also some interference on the Van der Westhuizen from one of the players in the mall.
A fantastic breakout there from the Wallabies. They've got to continue to have this courage to go with the ball.
So the Wallabies are sticking to their guns. They're playing the ball in hand rugby. The boxer kicking the leather off it here today. And it's 12-all.
Behind me, they sing, they still call Australia home. And imagine everyone at home, the spirit of rugby. All over, they're all up watching.
Here come the replacements, Chris. Ollie LaRue, Albert Vandenberg, the 25-year-old who plays with the Cats and Griquas, ready to come onto the field. Here's Andrews. Eels just couldn't get there. De Beer and Mullenauer. That's Andre Fenta, 10-meter line. A little bit of fence up quickly. De Beer again. Clever kick. Skinstad's there, so is Fleck. Just though Gregan was one of the Australian players holding on. They play on quickly. Van der Westhuizen. Durant. Australia desperately defend. Harry towed it through. Australia losing ahead.
Well, this is a crucial time for the Australians. 12-12. South Africa with a scrum feed, 15 metres from the Australians' line. They have to dig deep this eight.
Richard Harry is down getting some attention. It might just be an opportunity to give the Wallabies a break. Owen Finnegan on, and on comes Ollie LaRue and also Albert Vandenberg.
I thought, Chris, they might have given the Oss one more go at the Australians at this scrum, but he's done a big job, the Oss. Strategic replacement.
Well, he doesn't like not playing a full game, Oz Durant. And he's had a very willing battle with Andrew Blades.
Yeah, Vandenberg and Durant certainly will add a lot of more speed to this Springbok forward pack.
They're two of the most mobile tight forwards in the World Cup. Vandenberg, the quickest lock in the international game. So Van der Westhuizen from the deep channel. Skinstad into Larkham. They're getting close to the goal line. Ollie LaRue. Kefu grabbed him. Can they get it to ground? It's held up.
Seemed to be going back.
Great work from the Wallabies at that point. That takes a lot of guts. Ollie LaRue got caught in behind and couldn't get the ball to ground.
Yep, it was Ollie LaRue, powered forward, excellent defence. Erasmus tried to rip it off him, to no avail.
But the Wallabies...
And that's a hard scrum, that's so low, that scrum. The pressure on there, Ollie LaRue fresh.
Well, the Wallabies are under the hammer at the moment. This is Shades of Ellis Park in 1998, the Tri Nations decider. The box playing it down in Australia's territory on that occasion, and that's the way it's worked out here.
Well, Steve Larkham, as we see Jason Little ready to hit the field.
Ben Tune to depart.
They really have struggled to get the possession here, the Wallabies. They've had to stand up to so much pressure.
So Jason Little, who made his test debut in Strasbourg against the French back in 1989, on to his 67th international.
Yeah, I think this is an indication that Rod McQueen's not all that happy with the way that Ben Sheen's been playing the game. It doesn't appear as though he's injured. Being Little on for a tactical move.
Mark Odrotsky makes a good charge. He was in the 1995 World Cup squads. Erasmus now steps into Giffen and Kefu. Wilson tried to pick it up. Van der Vesthuizen. De Beer again. Little pass for Muller. Horan was there. So was Larkham. Here comes Ollie LaRue, but this is Fleck. Spots a gap. Straight through. Robbie Fleck. Van der Vesthuizen. Kip Larkham threw a pass to Horan, and they scramble out of jail.
Well, again, it was De Beer hanging back, looking for the drop goal, which gave Fleck the opportunity to slide through some defence.
He's attracting the flies, and Fleck is a good man. He does take the ball hard, and he's so good in those situations, but scrambling work, but Larkham and Horan again to save the day.
You know, he is good, he's elusive, he can step, one of the few in the Springbok teams who can really shimmy off a foot, but again, it's all straight through the middle.
Springboks are turning the screws here. They've made up 6 points. That wasn't straight.
Cool, that's a let off. This will give the Australians an opportunity to get into Springbok territory. Just been very frustrating for all the players out there that kept their cool over the last 5 minutes.
We're past the halfway point of this second term. 12 all the score. Stephen Larkham. Low kick over Rousseau's head. Jason Little sprinting hard. The fresh man, eager to go. Good tackle!
Well, they really have identified the Sabres being a weakness out wide. We've seen to him three times during this game. Not a very solid player in physical sense. Jason Little all over him.
There's no way Jason's first involvement in the game, he was going to miss him. Good play by Larkin, put it in behind. The crucial thing is, the Wallabies should win this ball.
Wallabies have to take advantage of their field position here. They need to restore some confidence as Giffen to Gregan and Larkham. Here's Horan, straight deep. Just caught from behind. Gregan wants it. Big chance for the Wallabies. Finnegan's on the field. Mum and Dad are in the stand. They're all offside there, South Africa. Larkham trying to weave his way through.
This is better play from Australia. As soon as Finnegan came on, the weaknesses are in behind the South African ruck and maul. And Gregan with that telltale pass behind, it's got him into trouble sometime, but with Finnegan, he's home. He's at home.
Can Matthew Burke break the deadlock? It's 12 all.
Gordon, you spoke about a famous scoreline at halftime, 12-6. This goes over. 15-12 was, in fact, the final result at Ellis Park in 95. That day, the Springboks prevailing.
A long way to go from here, though, Nick. We'll see Matthew Burke get this, and then it's going to be a monumental finish from there.
Can Matthew Burke put the Wallabies back in the lead? He sure can. Australia 15-12.
Well, from the kickoff at half-time, the Springboks really pinned the Wallabies down to their own 25. They've got to try and work this one out.
Well, Gordon, you said 128 years of rugby history. 129 years ago, the Tenterfield Saddler opened his shop in that great New South Wales country town of Tenterfield. And that's a bit of Australian history, and today we're going to live up to that 128 years.
Big kick downfield by Stephen Larkham to Rousseau, and Montgomery now just outside his quarter. Kefu's hanging back for the kick. So is Joe Roth. Swirling in the breeze. Nice reply there from Roth. He wants the bounce. Sensational kick.
How sweet. That lands right in front of us here in the commentary box. Now the pressure goes back on the Springbok slide out. Watch Joe Roth. Left foot. Bang.
Come off his foot like a rocket. Look, inches. Millimeters in fact.
And won't they try and pinch this? Look at John Eels trying to work out the formation. They've gone to three men, but Eels will go up for this.
Taken away by Vandenberg. Oh! Tackle without the ball there on Skinstad. Finnegan the man.
No, he's got him 3-2. They were confused by the line-out. We had Greg in his hooker. We had another man at halfback, three in the line-out.
Well, I tell you what. Skinstad was taken out here without the ball. Watch it. He'd already lost it.
Had a big look.
Tremendous play there by Owen Finnegan. Perhaps he did arrive close to the crucial moment.
John Eels there just still questioning Derek Bevan. I must say, I couldn't see the 3-2. I thought it was 3-on-3.
There were two scrum halves.
And where was the hooker?
That's the question.
Australia ahead 15-12. Eels at the back. He's just got telescopic arms. Ollie LaRue came through but knocked down.
Well, there's another let off for the Wallabies. A chance to reset, catch their breath, think through where they go from here. John Eels, super jump at the back. And that was well picked by Derek Bevan. Centre, the man responsible.
Wallaby scrum holds firm. Here's Larkham. Almost goes to through. They've taken it to the 10-metre line. John Eels leading the way that time. Horan, hospital pass there to Burke. Pitched by Herbert. Blades cleans out. Here's Kefu. Torai Kefu gets in behind Gregan again. Giffen, Little, tries to straighten. Gregan, good continuity here from the Wallabies. They're looking hungry. Torai Kefu goes on all fours, then back through his legs. Horan. Dan Herbert to the quarter line now. They're getting closer. Australia leading 15-12. Larkham, straight into Vandenberg. Gregan, they're offside again. Professional foul there by Otto. Referee says let's play some advantage. Burke! Australia so close. Kefu was there. Metres to go. Larkham wants it. Stephen Larkham. Joe Roth. Wallabies 6 metres out. South Africa holding on. That's Finnegan. 5 to go. Crucial point of the match here. Horan! Caught by Yanni De Beer, they smuggle it back. Burke is in there. He has it. Here's Larkham, he wasn't expecting it. Took the right option. There's only three backs out here on the left. Gregan now, still caught in that ruck. Finnegan, put his head down. Tremendous pressure here from the Wallabies. Burke! 2 to go. How many faces? Gregan! He got it! George Gregan has got the try for the Wallabies.
No, it's a penalty.
No, he said.
Didn't release.
Well, let's watch very closely. George Gregan goes low. Rousseau onto him. Across comes Thunderbest Heisen. Ball through. Looks like short of the lines. Good referee. 16 phases of play. Super control from the Wallabies.
How can the referee say he didn't release there when the tackling player was holding it in and then handled on the ground?
Yeah, that's clear here. Bevan had supposedly the best position and he comes up with the wrong decision.
So controversial moment. South Africa survives. No try. 15-12 to the Wallabies.
And Skinstad off. What a surprise. We've now got Andre Boss on.
Well, it was great continuity, and that's the essence of the Australians game. But give credit to the Springboks defence as well. As Simon mentioned, 16 phases at play, and they didn't crack. Let's see how close Gregan did go from this other angle. Look at that desperate defence. So close. The box survived.
So the referee goes up. His hand was straight up. We thought he was awarding the try, but he's ruled a penalty.
I'll tell you what, it was AFL, a bit ball up. Both players responsible.
Well, the skin move to bring Skinstad off is an indication that Kepu's had a blinder. He's been unable, the superstar, the pretty boy of South African rugby. He's a wonderful player in the loose, but this game isn't suited for that of Bobby Skinstad. On comes Stephen Teblanche.
Yes, Stephen Teblanche coming on, a prolific try scorer for the Springboks. 5-1 test match against the Italians.
It's been a war of attrition, plenty of tactical substitutes.
Vandenberg, the lanky lock. They drive him over the quarter. De Beer. So they're out of the danger zone now. Jason Little on halfway. He was strongly met by Otto. They've got to do it all again now, Australia, after holding it for, must have been 10 phases. Here's Horan, around Muller. What a break! Tim Horan, Eels is with him. Little was on the outside. Gregan again, there's an overlap here. South Africa's offside out here. Joe Roth, the referee's playing advantage. They're all offside out here.
Well, certainly Robbie Fleck was offside out wide, but Bevan has gone infield. Almost a certain 3 points here for Burke again. Great continuity, terrific break, Tim Horan.
But the thing missing, a psychological blow, would have been the try. This only puts him 6 points clear if he gets a watch. Horan, Superman. Just, he's so good in this game. Finds Eels on his shoulder.
Strong tackle there from Von der Vesthuizen. Eels there, he had Little on his right. Didn't see Little, but they were able to recycle and go long left, which created the penalty.
15-12, a possible three-pointer coming up. Nathan Gray comes out for Australia. Hero Tim Horan has departed. Gray on for his 17th test, and he is getting a great ovation, Tim Horan. What a superb performance coming out of his sick bed this morning.
And the one that counts, the ovation from his boys on the bench here. They're just delighted at the contribution that Tim Horan has made.
Matthew Burke raises the flags. Australia's out by 6. 18 plays 12.
Again, it comes down from this kick from the Springboks. As Rod McQueen looking also tense, Rod Kafer, John Mackay, Tim Lane, Jeff Miller worked so hard this whole year, but especially this last week, trying to outthink this Springbok side.
And can't you see that blood draining out of their faces? That slight paleness that comes with the nervousness, that belly full of flies.
Great take there by Finnegan. His strength has been prominent since he's come on. Now Larkham. This kick straight to DeBlanche, not well directed. He can have a go here. Clever little grubber, nasty one for Burke.
Well, that 3 points that Burke has just scored is so crucial. The Wallabies for almost two matches now. Their defensive line hasn't looked like cracking, but the Springboks have to get that five-pointer and then follow it up with a conversion. They can't go for the three. They have to keep ball in hand and try and get the try.
A strange kick from Larkin that way. Larkin that one. DeBlanche read it early and was right in position.
Otto going high. Better work here from South Africa. They're driving up the short side. Marka Drotsky. 10 metres out from the goal line here. And Van der Vesthuizen knocked on.
You see the strength of George Gregan in that rolling ball. He came in on LaRue and stopped him. It was so vital.
Just that weight of Eels at the last minute. Watch here, they stop them. Eels come from the side. The ball's banging. He hits there hard. And just in the reaching for the ball, he just loses it forward.
Crucial errors, probably about 4 minutes of normal time remaining. There'll be some injury time to play. The Wallabies are so close to advancing to 6 November in the Millennium Stadium in Cardiff.
Nail-biting time now for both sides. Gregan for Larkham. Wasn't going to risk coming out on this left side. Here's Rousseau. The gap opens. He's found a bit of space. He went too far. This is Ollie LaRue. 38 metres out. Australia ahead by 6 points. Fleck. Ran out of ideas that time. Flatline defence here from Australia. Van der Vesthuizen goes himself. He's made 15. Great charge from the scrum half. Now to be out. He takes them on. Gregan. He's been phenomenal in defence here today. Wallabies now. Converted try would put South Africa in the lead. They have a chance for three more.
This is going to be a crucial decision for the box. Do they go to the line out? Do they take a tap? Or do they elect the three?
I think they'll take the three. I think you said there's 8 minutes left.
Watch that tackle on Gregan de Beer. Just mows him down. Now, the question becomes here, where the penalty came from.
Two players together lifted the ball up off the ground. Now, somebody had to be penalised for picking it up, and it was Australia.
So very clearly there, just under 5 minutes. What a titanic struggle. We knew it would be. 18-12 at the moment. This is an almost certain 3 points for Yanni De Beer. Straight out in front. 18 plays, 15 now for South Africa. It was 12-6 at halftime.
What a scramble we're going to get in the next four. The Wallabies will be desperate to be everywhere. Mallet knows time is running out. Last chances.
Got to be a good kickoff. It's got to be a smart kickoff. Otto Thunderberg, go high for the ball.
Whatever it takes here for Australia. They've just got to work so hard off the ball, get in positions to make tackles.
High, well-directed kick from Burke near the touchline. Andre Fenter just outside his quarter. Ollie LaRue with a big charge. Wallabies calling for the race. They pinched it. And Harry was loitering offside.
Discipline must be crucial here. The box continue to attack Australia near the rucks. They've got to watch those gaps, especially from Captain Van der Vesthuizen.
Yeah, Richard Harry, mile offside then.
Well, this is the half they don't want to be in.
Three-man line out, Thunderberg in.
Thunderberg got it, Mark Androtsky. Harry pulled it down. That's silly play. They can't afford to give any stupid penalties away now. Otherwise, we're into extra time. Ollie LaRue going in place.
Got to keep them away from it.
Here's the drop goal attempt. No, he changed his mind. A bad option. Joe Ross kick is charged down. Gregan now. Bad pass to Burke. Self-destruction here from the Wallabies, but they get the penalty.
Oh, there is a God.
How unfortunate for that. That's a tough penalty. Technically, probably right. Poor pass from George. Crucial drop. And once he was on the ground, they can't come through and dive on him.
2 minutes and 15 seconds to go. Derek's got a sense of humour. Let's take our hat off to Derek Bevan today. He's done a good job. He's been cool in the crisis. The Wallabies haven't always been cool in the crisis, though.
Well, there's one thing the Wallabies have to do here is pull this ball down and drive and drive and keep the ball in hand. Just whittle those 2 minutes away, but it's got to be excellent control at the breakdown.
The box will be looking for a three-pointer and force it into extra time. Just over 1.5 to go. What a penalty there for Australia. Obstruction in the lineup.
I think we're home.
We hear all these Wallaby players there just shouting the referee, asking for the penalty, and it came their way. Now, Matthew Burke driving this one downfield.
As you say, Simon, what is crucial now? Keep ball in hand, two-handed catch. I'd be tending to roll the ball, just maul it at the South Africans, or use people like Gray and Herbert, bash it up the middle.
A minute to go. Australia ahead 18-15. Can they do it? Giffen pulled it down with one arm. Australia winding down the clock here. Coming back now for Gregan. Referee wanted it out. Larkham. Nathan Gray. Well tackled. They must hold the ball here. Here's Larkham. Fainted to kick, then changed his mind. Gregan again. South Africa wanting to break out. Somehow get the ball out of Australia's hands. 40 seconds to go. Kefu! Burke lost ahead. This is South Africa's chance. Burke was tackled as he tried to take that ball. There's an overlap. Fleck to Blotz. Roth was there.
Great cover, Joe Roth. He took on three men drifting across. They certainly had an overlap. But it's that kind of desperation off the ball that is saving the day for Australia.
Remember, no defending World Cup champion has gone through to the final in the following World Cup. That's the hoodoo. Can Australia prevail? Narka Drotsky. Erasmus. Seconds to go. No penalties from the Australians here.
Up there, green ball. It's a rock up you get.
Referee will look at his clock. Surely will be the last set piece of the game.
He's right in the blue.
Yep, the referee said we're on time, so the time is up. He's got to have the scrum.
Van der Westhuizen knows that. He's telling his players they have to use this. One more stoppage and the game is Australia's.
Well, they'll be driving and trying to get closer for De Beer to have the opportunity to drop that goal.
Well, cast your mind back to the semi-final, Australia-France in 1987 at Concorde Oval. The French snatch victory through Serge Blanco in the corner in the dying seconds. Australia doesn't want a repeat of that nightmare. They're ahead by 3 points. Last scrum of the game. Here comes Muller. Gregan's there. To Blotch. Beat one. Australia gets back onside. Van der Westhuizen, Eels got him. Now Benta. Volley's going in, and there's the penalty they didn't want to give away.
This is unbelievable. Tough kick. He's up to it, De Beer. The breakdown in the final play of discipline. Just leave it.
Well, it looks as though it was Nathan Gray. Couldn't see who it was, actually.
I think it was Finnegan.
Was it?
Well, I think it might have been Michael Foley, unfortunately.
Anyway, no scapegoats. This guy's still got to pilot it through.
Well, he was the hero last week in Paris. What's going to happen here?
And Gordon, 10 minutes each way if it does go over.
Yes, we're into extra time, Nick. It happened in the World Cup final. Nick Mallett. Alan Solomons, they can't look.
Who can?
But what a man to have in this situation. Yanni De Beer, they said he'd be replaced in the second half by Henry Honeyball.
We want somebody to hold this ball, which will be a distraction for him.
Van der Westhuizen's coming up. The ball won't stay on the mound.
This goes wide and Australia are through to the final.
the most important kick of Yanni De Beer's life. This would force a draw and extra time. So we're going to have a 10-minute break by the sound of it, and then we come back for the extra time. What drama here at Twickenham. Back very shortly. And there, the penalty goal that leveled the score. And what about the reaction here from Nick Mallett? 18-all. Yanni De Beer and Matthew Burke have shared the points between them equally. So now it's 10 minutes each way extra time, and if no winner can be found, then the winner shall be the team to score the most tries in the game. Well, we haven't had any tries at the moment. Matthew Burke with 6 penalties, De Beer with 5 penalties and a drop goal. So no tries, that doesn't apply. The team which has the least number of players ordered from the field throughout the tournament shall be declared the winner if after this exhaustive protest no winner had emerged. And that then means that Brendan Fenter has been sent off for South Africa. Australia has had no one sent from the field, so South Africa in that sense is looking down the barrel if we're still level at the end of extra time.
Well, the critical thing from here on is the fitness of both sides. I think looking through this World Cup tournament that the Australians do have a slight fitness edge on their South African opponents. There have been a number of substitutions already made by both sides out there, and the Australians got a few more players up their sleeve than South Africa.
They really are irrepressible, the South Africans. This is their 11th match in their history of World Cup rugby. They're yet to lose a match. They've hung in there, as Gordon said, the great escape. And Australia put them away.
Joel Stransky did it in 1995 in the cup final. Yanni De Beer with that last gasp penalty goal after Australia infringed well into injury time.
And Henry Honeyball's on, De Beer's off.
It's quite an amazing change.
No, De Beer's still on.
Honeyball will probably be in its inside centre, replacing Pieter Muller. The Australians, I'm sure, the tactics will be to keep ball in hand to try and continue to run the Springboks ragged.
Psychologically tough for the Australians. They've gone so close and should have won this with full 80 minutes. Now the Springboks with the hope of coming back.
Well, I have shown great composure, Simon. You've got to rise to the occasion. Will they have the maturity?
You can really touch and feel the tension now. Henry Honeyball is on the field. And he'll be playing on for Pieter Muller. So Henry Honeyball playing at inside centre. His first test match in several months.
Big clash between Honeyball and Gray. Two big physical men.
Honeyball's 34th international. So if at the end of extra time we're still level, it's most tries scored in the game. If there are no tries, then it's the team that had the most players sent off during the tournament. And South Africa is the only team out there that's had someone sent off, Brendan Fenter. So the Springboks just out from their quarter. Another 20 minutes to go here at Twickenham. Yanni De Beer with a monster kick. That's gone
65 metres on the fly. Here's Joe Roth. Not getting the touch. Thunder Vesthuizen, this great scrum half and skipper. To blocks. And the kick has gone touch and goal.
It was great play by Gregan off the ball. So we see one of the South Africans, the captain, down. Gregan realised that he had to chase that man, Teo Bloch, and he covered him.
Great play by Thunder Vesthuizen, and he is such a dangerous player in close. Just adds pace to the move. They surge forward when he gets the ball.
Good engagement there by the Wallaby front row. Here's Gray in close. Getting over the advantage line. Gregan and Larkham inside his quarter. Off the side of his boot. And back to halfway.
Steve Larkham won't be happy with that kick. These vital 20 minutes is all about territory. Springboks have a line-out throw on Australia's half.
Fenter really hurt when Nathan Gray came hurtling through there on that ball.
Andre Voss has blood on his eye. He'll have to come off for a blood bin. Great opportunity for him, the former Queensland Reds player. Enormous work rate, so they're cleaning him up and skin stats coming back on.
Well, that's probably not a bad move for South Africa with Skinstad having had a rest. Vandenberg got it. De Beer. Clever little kick. De Beer. Foley couldn't hold on. South Africa have it. Ollie LaRue. Herbert with a crunching tackle.
De Beer in behind.
Drop goals on here for South Africa. He's gone a long way back and they've conceded a penalty.
Didn't come initially, but it came eventually. Thunder Vesthuizen picked up the ball. I don't know what he says, who held onto it or who stopped it.
I'd love to see the broader shot then. The Australian players seem to have good discipline in that breakdown.
Yeah, I'm scratching my head, I must say. Thunder Vesthuizen made the mistake. He appealed for the penalty. The appeal won the day.
Well, the most crucial decision in this game was the Gregan effort where he went to the goal line. He was penalised for holding onto the ball, and the tackling player was also holding on for dear life on the ground. And look at the rain shooting in now. So Yanni De Beer to put South Africa back out in front. He's got it. 21 plays 18.
That's the first time they've been in front on the scoreboard as the rain really starts to tumble down. This is not going to aid Australia's cause of getting back in front of the box.
Well, the hearts of all those Wallabies on the bench slumped, and De Beer kicked that penalty to draw level, and again a little feeling of deja vu to get this close, but Wallabies aren't finished yet.
Heavy rain. The Springboks in front in the semi-final for the first time. Erasmus there. Yanni De Beer. Larkin tried to charge it down, but De Beer has found extra metres with his punt kicking in this extra time period.
You can see on that occasion De Beer having to take the ball into his body. That's what's going to make it so difficult for the Wallabies. The ball security in this rain is the most important thing. The transfer becomes harder.
Foley using the towel on the ball.
David Gibbon with good skills. Gregan again. And Larkham, it's a slippery ball now though. Kefu met a brick wall that time. Gregan. And Larkham. Jarrock. Gregan knocked on.
You've got to make sure they don't panic. The Wallabies has plenty of time left. The continuity is the most important thing. Fortunately, they've got the scrum feed.
Well, that time the Springbok making the first knock on. It's Thunder Vesthuizen.
Stephen Larkham. Joe Roth. Joe Roth. Lovely shimmy. 5 metres to go. Quick ball needed. And that's a penalty. Again, a deliberate offence there by South Africa. They're calling for a penalty try there, the Australians.
Well, someone's got to go. How many professional fouls can you give away in a game?
Well, the referee's saying if he'd have played it with his hands, they'd have had the penalty try. Let's have a look at it. The ball goes to ground, it gets cleared beautifully and quickly. And it hits De Beer just loitering in that area. And you've got to...
You can't tell me that's not rehearsed.
Well, he's done it twice so far in the game.
The one thing was, though, that De Beer wasn't watching the ball coming. He was loitering. The try looked on for all money on the right flank.
But it just shows you the fallacy of not having a sin bin at test match level. Burke needs this to level again. No kick is easy now. Try was there for the Australians. This to make it 21 all. Smooth as silk for Matthew Burke. Thrust and carry at Twickenham in this World Cup semi-final. 21 all.
That was a wonderfully worked move that saw Joe Roth into space. The ball came back on the inside from Gray. There are holes in this Springbok defence if the Wallabies can create the continuity.
And De Beer goes deep that time. 7 minutes gone. Working the angle up the touchline.
That's a good kick from Larkham. Really gave his players a lot of heart.
Vandenberg, spring heel leaper. Here's Andre Voss. David Wilson, the tackler. Getting into range again for Yanni De Beer, Ollie LaRue. They did it on the third phase against England. Percy Montgomery standing back this time. Yanni De Beer, it's a bad pass from the scrum half. Nothing wrong with that kick though.
And Steve Larkham all over De Beer. He realises the threat, he poses. De Beer didn't get a good ball, changed his option. He's put his team hard on attack. Slippery possession. Australia should be throwing to two.
Well, big attention to the ball here from Michael Foley.
Probably the lob ball as opposed to the more direct throw will be the call of the day. John Eales at four.
You can feel the tension here, but imagine those watching in Australia in the pubs and the clubs and in bedrooms and lounges everywhere.
What a great take there by Eales. Here's Larkham. And Gray, they're running it from their goal line. That's really been the difference between the two sides. And Larkham. This is Rousseau. Coming down inside Australia's border. Matthew Burke was there.
Again, a poor decision from Rousseau. He should have kept that ball in hand.
Burke taking more time with this kick. And the Wallabies are happy there. We've had 9 minutes and 15 seconds in this first half of extra time. It's 21 all.
Well, it's been certainly a physical match. Tough up front, tough right across the paddock. These players are going into their 90th minute of rugby. Probably 95 with injury time.
Vandenberg has been invincible at the front. Yanni De Beer again. The Gary Owens come off the side of his boots. Going only 20 metres ahead. Herbert got it. Can Australia get some more points before the break? It was a kick in general play.
From the catch, yellow ball.
So Australia gets the scrum feeds.
Well, Daniel Herbert just enveloped then by Kaino Otto. Did so well to hang on.
This is why they put in the time at Caloundra.
they've trained for this moment, not just to go to the wire 80 minutes, but to go even longer if necessary. Herbert that time, and catching the ball and bringing it down, ensures possession for the Wallabies into the scrum. In doing so, cramps up because he's in a bent over position, shuffling crab-like to the line.
Still the rain coming down, time's up. This is the last set piece of this first half of extra time. The trainers and physios depart. We're on halfway. Larkham's on the short side here. High tackle. Referee was happy.
Half time.
So the players will change over. The first period of extra time, it was 3 points each, so it's 21 all. We'll take a short break. So we're back here at Twickenham. It's just unbearable for everyone. Some of the crowd trying to burst into Waltzing Matilda. They'll need every strain of that, and the Wallabies need every little bit of support, the force, the spirit from home as well.
Well, it's... they do, and the Springboks have got the kickoff, so immediately the challenge is there for the Australians to fight their way back out of their own territory.
Well, from Australia, they need to yell from there. Those dingo cubs from Alice Springs, let's give us a big howl, because these boys need a lift.
10 minutes. There's no points, or it's square after 10. We go through. Ventar for South Africa, having been sent off in the pool matches. This is where you've got to stand up and be counted.
Imagine the tension at Joey's College, where all the students are up late watching this. God, tension is incredible on the sideline. The Wallaby bench, I've never seen them riveted, just ashen face.
Well, Chris, as a boarder, Matthew Burke was watching in 1991 at Joey's.
I think the only bloke enjoying this will be John Harp, New Zealand coach.
Okay. 10 minutes remaining. South Africa wanting to keep Australia pinned down here. Percy Montgomery over halfway. Has a crack. Good ball coming for Ollie LaRue. They're saying no penalties, the Australians. Erasmus. De Beer standing back again near halfway. Good tackle there on Vasaki. De Beer still standing straight behind Van der Vesthuizen for the drop. Instead, he kicks for the corner. Out on the full.
Ooh, could this be the turning point of this epic contest? De Beer had the opportunity to go the 3 points. He's opted for the very successful kick he used in the last 10 minutes.
The hero and the villain. De Beer's been the hero for the Springboks in kicking the points to draw 11, and the villain, as far as Australia's concerned, getting in the way of two very promising try-scoring moves. But Eels now, the experience of this man from 91, he needed to marshal his forces.
David Giffen. Vandenberg all over him that time. Stephen Larkham. And Kefu. Kefu, a little step. Bring it again. Larkham on his left foot. Wants to land it inside the touchline.
This is where they want to be. Can they pinch one of the box balls? They've got to apply the pressure.
It's the time to work on the line-out. They will take a short line-out, the Springboks, so that it makes it easier for the man to avoid Eels.
Well, they just can't compete with Vandenberg. He's too good. 203 centimetres. Andre Vos had to stop there for that pass. Van der Vesthuizen, Eels got him. Captain versus captain. Ollie LaRue rucks it back. Now De Beer. Half volley. Nicely judged kick.
Well, good skills from De Beer. A lot of pressure, ball's wet. Half volley, got it, cleared it well.
Field position is so crucial.
Connor's coming on for the Australians. We'll probably see Giffen come off.
It's a crucial time to be coming on. Giffen's going to stay out there. Lundenberg's going to do his best to pinch this. Now Giffen's coming off and Connor's on. So Mark Connor's on for his ninth test match. The Brisbane solicitor.
And I think they think Connor's might be able to pinch one of the Springbok balls.
Fantastic jump from Eels. And Nathan Gray puts his head down. A steamroller that time. Drop goal attempt from Markham. Look at this. Stephen Larkham has put Australia in the lead.
Don't celebrate too soon, guys. There's still at least 5 minutes to go. But what a wonderful kick. The boot is on the other foot for the Springboks. That's almost 50 metres.
Daniel Herbin, all sorts of problems as we see this ball sail over. Larkham, long way out. Watch it go. Sensational.
This will be a kick remembered for a long time. Look at the smile on Stephen Larkham. It didn't even go to ground the right way. He's delighted.
So Jason Little now. Huge kick downfield to Rousseau. Australia ahead 24-21. We've got 6 minutes to go. Rousseau. Coming back slowly. De Beer. Hefty kick downfield. Burke across. To Blanche coming through. It came off to Blanche, I think. It did. Australia's line-out throw.
Well, Matthew Burke again keeping his cool down there. Rolling ball.
He's cramping up too, Simon. Is Matthew Burke, and who wouldn't be?
Come on, Australia. All those watching Sevens coverage, the spirit of rugby. Give us a yell from home, for God's sake. They need it. They need it desperately.
Will they be screaming in the streets?
Bring back Bill.
If the Wallabies get there.
There's a number of guys cramping up. You can see in the middle of your picture. I think that's Dan Herbert down, trying to get rid of the cramps in the calves. Burke's in trouble. This has been a titanic struggle. The discipline must prevail.
I recall in 1991 when Australia won the semi-final against New Zealand, Mark O'Neill, the state cricketer, ran out into the street in his birthday suit and screamed all the way up and down.
Well, Gordon, if we can hang on here, I think the commentary team should do the same here in London.
I'm with you. I've got the wrestling suit on ready.
You heard of a river called the Thames, Chris?
You get it. Bring it on. Come on, boys.
Now back to business. Michael Foley, the vital throw this line out.
Still the rain comes down. Australia ahead 24-21. Gregan then. For Larkham. This one's to Montgomery. He didn't get the distance on that he wanted. Montgomery's going to attack here with Rousseau, who loses it. Well, we've seen crucial mistakes from Rousseau. Larkham's there. And is the pendulum turning Australia's way?
And isn't the rain now coming down big time? We're running to the last 4 minutes. Rousseau again stuffs up.
Well, I called in normal time that we're at home. I'm not going to call it again. The Gregan should know, in these conditions, as we try and wind down the clock, the short side is your friend.
Drenching rain on the sideline, it's dripping off every part of me, and I don't give a rat.
Van der Westhuizen's been penalised again. He's been caught for the second time for coming round too quickly.
He's panicked.
Three-pass injury.
Well, that's no, that's probably out.
Yeah, I agree with Van der Westhuizen.
Short, there it is.
Interesting, going for goal. I thought they may have played for the touchline. Burke will take his time here. 6 points, if he can get the margin, hopefully is enough.
Well, with Daniel Herbert back on halfway, still with cramp, you might have to see Whittaker onto the wing, Jason Little into the centres.
So there's about 3 minutes and 40 seconds to go.
John Eales should be marshalling his troops. We have to have a wall of gold following this ball through. If it doesn't get the legs, you can be assured these guys will try and counter.
Australia have it by three. We're in the second half of extra time in this World Cup semi-final. The 1991 champion against the defending champs. Distance is good. Look at Matthew Burke. 6 points to Australia. That's the lead. 27, plays 21.
And we can hear those boarders roar from Joey. Proud of this man. If he was here in commentary with me, I'd kiss him.
Well, now they really have to start to shut the game down because the three-point buffer is now gone. 6 points is great.
South Africa come through. Finnegan pulled it down. In Aussie rules fashion. Stephen Larkham standing on the short side. Just up the touchline. Rousseau makes sure this time. Ollie LaRue. Australia's defence has been colossal. They've conceded only one try in this tournament. South Africa two.
Again, hands in the ball situation there. I think Andrew Blades the offender.
Andrew Blades was the offender and he got enough warning out there. We just don't need to do this. So close to victory.
2 minutes remaining. 2 minutes between a place in the World Cup final.
Agony and ecstasy.
Converted try is needed by the Springboks.
The Springboks from here will pick down and drive. That's their big strength, those forwards.
They have to score a try now, South Africa. They have to score a try.
Ben Churns on the field, Herbert off.
Well, the defences have stood up. The previous World Cups have shown that if you can repel what the opposition throw at you, you can prevail. Australia have 2 minutes to repel it.
South Africa through Vandenberg. They try to drive towards the quarter. Erasmus, De Beer steps. Caught by Wilson. Eager Australian defenders, Van der Vesthuizen dangerous here. Ollie LaRue. Henry Honeyball's gone out here. He gets it on the fly. It's a tester for Burke. It's a good kick. Burke has to be safe here. He got the mark. It went too far.
Well, it did go too far, Gordon. But under that sort of pressure, in wind, in driving rain, that is great skill.
Fine touch and it's all over.
If he gets it into touch, Australia's through to the final. And Matthew Burke.
Row Q.
Look at the Wallabies. Look at the elation of this Australian team. What a test of character. They have prevailed in the semi-final. The champions are out. Wallabies 27, South Africa 21.
What an unbelievable promise from the Wallabies. The team of lightness defeats the team of darkness. The Wallabies, the more positive side out there, really trying to score tries. The Springboks playing a war of attrition. The rightful side goes through to the World Cup final.
And we saw the hero there. He had a number 10 on his jumper, Nick Barr-Jones. The drop goal that broke the deadlock in injury time.
Well, it was Stransky for South Africa in 95, but that man, and what a wonderful drop goal it was. He normally keeps ball in hands. He's the general out there, but this time it was the golden right boot from 45 metres out that has got the Wallabies through to Cardiff and 80 minutes from history.
He is a genius, Steve Larkham. He broke